All right, call the Plaza 1006 Corporation meeting to order. Board of Business is discussion and possible action on the following items. First one we have is consent agenda on approved minutes from 11/20/2018 special meeting and approved minutes from the 4/02/2019 regular meeting.
I will move to approve minutes from the 11/20/18 special meeting and the 4/02/19 regular meeting.
And I will second that.
Councilwoman Amanda Fenwick and Councilwoman Jan Bailey, second. All in favor? All right. New business is possible action and approval of the following items. Appointment of officers and directors of Plaza 1006 Corporation.
I will move to appoint Angie Terrell as director and Kurt Otten as president of Plaza 1006.
I'll second that.
All right, so appointment by Amanda for Kurt Otten for president and Angie Terrell as a director. And Jan Bailey, second. All in favor? Any opposed? All right. Welcome.
Welcome.
Welcome to Plaza 1006.
Meeting adjourned.
Oops, your junk mail.
That was 6:32. All right, next one's call meeting order for City of Clear Lake Shores City Council meeting, regular meeting on July 16th. Absent is Christie Lyons and Councilman Mark Thompson. And we'll do the Pledge of Allegiance to the flag, the United States of America and the Texas flag.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Honor the Texas flag. I pledge allegiance to thee, Texas, one state, under God, one and indivisible.
Y'all make sure you talk into your mic.
Oh, thank you. I was gonna put that on mic.
Yeah.
So we do have videos working, so I advise everybody to make sure they use their microphones so we get better audio on them. And with that, we'll start with the reports from council. Again, Thompson's absent and Ms. Lyons is absent. Councilwoman Terrell?
That was my first item I was gonna bring up. Huge thank you to Kurt and Amanda for getting our YouTube channel up and going. We're using the city cameras and Brent or whoever else was involved in that project. We're using the city court cameras and we're taping this meeting and then we're rebroadcasting to our YouTube channel. It should be up within days of the meeting, so y'all will be able to follow along when you don't come to council meetings. Thank you. I know that was a huge undertaking. Thank you.
I'll teach you how to do it.
No, I'm already on Plaza 10. That's enough. And a reminder, speak into the mic, except for maybe Alan Batchelor. I don't know if you're here, but everyone else, speak into the mic.
All right, next is, thank you, Councilman Terrell. Next is Councilwoman Bailey.
Thank you. Attended the Emergency Services Board meeting last night at the Kima Volunteer Fire Department. Basically, we elected officers and had some new attendees there, and I'm sure Amanda can say more about that. Did you get anything else?
All right, thank you, Councilwoman Bailey. Councilwoman Fenwick?
Thank you, Mayor. I have a couple things tonight. First of all, Chief Hahn and Chief Cook, thank you guys for your support during our 4th of July activities. I know, Chief Hahn, you didn't have the staff here during our Saturday day, but we got rained out most of the day anyway. But we had great presence at our parade, so appreciate both of you and your teams being here for that. In front of you, council members, Mayor, Christie, staff, you have our Facebook stats for the last 28 days or so, so June 18th through July 15th, and I will email these to Councilwoman Lyons and Councilman Thompson as well, so if you have any questions about that, please let me know. But we have good engagement and good reach on our Facebook, and we'll continue to use that as one of our communication methods. And then I don't have anything else other than what's on the agenda that we'll discuss later.
All right, thank you, Councilman Woman Fenwick. All right, so I'm going to have your attention for a little bit, for a second or two, or maybe a minute or two. Today we celebrate the launch of Apollo 11 from 50 years ago. So what we talk about here is JFK stated in Rice Stadium September 12, 1962, to put a man on the moon. In this decade, we choose to go to the moon. in this decade and do the other things that because they are easy, not because they are easy, because they are hard. So that was 50 years ago. We launched three astronauts on board Apollo 11, Neil Armstrong, Buzz Aldrin, John Collins. On Sunday, 50 years ago, we landed Neil and Buzz on the moon. Can you imagine that being completed? That was Neil was the first person to set foot on the moon. So I want to welcome my dad, Hank Cotton himself. He was involved with the mission control and helped train a lot of the people you see on the TV and stuff. So it's amazing to see him here. I didn't know if he was going to make it down or not. I wanted to give him a big proclamation and stuff like that, but we didn't. But anyway, I'll give you a Clear Lake Shores pin later. So just a big round of applause for that. So another amazing feat, and I bet you, or that was all an amazing feat, and do you know another amazing feat that happened that same day? And that was you were able to watch it on TV live in your living room, and no one thought that was going to happen either. So NASA's Apollo missions inspired an entire generation in ways that will still being felt today, just as my dad did for me. I truly believe in our responsibility to instill that same passion in the next generation, the kids who will take us even further into the universe. So go for the kids. Second was the council videos. We covered that, and then we are still working on the boats over at 19 Tyndall. Most of those have moved out, and we're working on the Willie Nelson boat. So I don't know if that got moved or not. That completes that. Staff reports, Police Department Chief Cook.
Both new police e-bikes are now completely outfitted for service, and we brought one of them here tonight for everyone to look at. We intend to send some of our newer officers to the next available Houston PD Police Bicycle Certification School. Currently, we have four officers already certified for police bicycle patrol. Electronic ticket rider update. Electronic ticket rider update. Not much progress since the last council meeting update. Superion did make updated printer adjustment settings to the software, but we've been unable to test those new settings because our Three Coast IT person, Dennis, has been off on vacation, and our PD officer, Sergeant Baylor, is currently in training all this week. We will try to get everyone together sometime next week. Marine Division, we had the police wave runners out in the lake this past weekend, and we intend to have them back out this coming weekend along with the police boat. Citizen training class by CLSPD. On this Thursday, July 18th, at 6:30 p.m., the Clear Lake Shores Police Department will instruct a surviving a critical incident training class here at the CLS Clubhouse. Snacks, drinks, weapon displays, and all classroom training material will be provided. This will be a very interesting and informative class, and everyone is encouraged to attend. That's all I have.
Chief Cook, I had a question. We saw you guys out there in the lake. That was fun. What dictates when we patrol the lake? And I know we have Marine certified police officers to do that, but when do we decide to do that, and when does that happen?
We do that when we absolutely can. We only have so many people. When they're out on vacation or in training, we'll try to get them out there on the weekends, on Friday, Saturday, and Sunday for a couple hours, not during the week.
So high usage and personnel willing, we get them out there. Excellent. Thank you, Chief.
Thank you, Chief Cook. And Building Official Kevin Harrell.
Mayor and Council, since our last meeting, I've issued 11 permits, all of them minor permits, no new construction. 19 Tyndall, for my last report, the owner had poured illegal concrete slab. I had that concrete removed and made the owner obtain a new contractor with a new permit, and they did pour that concrete, and I did inspect it. That was last week. Also, the electrical that was supplying power to 19 Tyndall and to live in boats. That was also disconnected July 11th on Thursday. The owner is currently looking for an electrician to reestablish proper electrical to both the house and the shore power for the boats. 311 Narcissus, I've currently got three quotes from contractors for the demolition. I'm waiting for two others. I will be bringing those quotes to you August 6th on our next meeting and asking for a demolition order. Code enforcement, I currently have four cases. Three of those cases are closed. One is still pending. As for the Willie Nelson boat, I spoke to the contractor this morning. He was going to pump out the boat today. He was going to have it removed day after tomorrow. He stated he didn't want to work on his birthday. So it should be gone by day after tomorrow. That's all I have.
Thanks, Kevin.
Thank you, Mr. Harrell. All right, Fire Chief Brent Hahn.
You want to grab Mark's?
One, two.
There
hello?
You go.
Okay. All right. Leaving Mayor and Council, since the clerk chores. In the month of June, 71 total calls, 21 being fire-related, 5 in Clear Lake Shores, 10 in Kema, 1 county, 5 mutual aid, 48 EMS first responder-related, 11 in Clear Lake Shores, 34 in Kema, 3 in the county, no mutual aid. Special operations, we had 2 marine call-outs, both in the county. The fire department activities, we attended Galveston County Firefighter Association meeting at 2 training drills. For emergency management, we had meetings with the OEM, a couple of weather conference calls, just about some bad weather that sprung up briefly in June. We did have the 2019 hurricane meeting here. We want to thank Clear Lake Shores for hosting that. I think that was a great combined meeting for everybody. Wish we could have seen more people, but some questions have come out. Where can we get some of the hurricane materials? The information material, if y'all will come by the fire station, or I'll leave some over at City Hall as well. We have plenty of handouts, checklists, protective bags for valuables. I'll leave some of those over at City Hall, or y'all can come to the fire station and pick some up. We did attend 2 after-action reports for the Kirby Barge incident. The first one was with the Galveston County Health Department, still waiting on the notes from that, and the next one was at where the Unified Command was in Harris County. Both of the meetings, the most prominent thing that came out of was the lack of communication, the exact communication, the type of communication, the delivery types of the communication, how it came out to the public. That was very, very well noted. They say there's still going to be a couple more meetings come out of that. I know there was some concerns. I talked to Councilman Matero a couple of times about some concerns and concerns of the citizens, and believe me, they were voiced. Very confident that they were voiced. Both Pasadena, Seabrook, us, same thing with League City and Galveston County, they were very well voiced. Still, if there's anybody that wants to send me an email about that concern, I'll be more than happy to forward that on. Fire Marshal's Office, we have totally 69 activities. Business occupancy, meaning construction or fire protection systems, 1 for Clear Lake Shores, 3 for Kema, fire inspections, fire system testing, and site visits, 10 in Clear Lake Shores, 48 Kema, 3 in the county, 4 fire plan reviews were done for Kema. We did receive 1 volunteer application for community special events. As we talked last meeting, we did participate in Chief Chris Reed's funeral, which was an honor for us. We participated in the Office Depot, support our local fire department. They have a water drive. Went up and did some pictures with them. And then at Jackie's Brick House, our high water vehicle, the local Jeep Club, asked us to come over and spend some time. They filled up the entire floor of the rear of that SRV that we have with water and Gatorade, almost 2 levels. So we want to definitely thank them for their time with that. Also, in the Chiefs report, there was a Chiefs Cup Texas Hold'em tournament benefiting the Kema Fire Department. that has been canceled. Tried to coordinate it. We were just unable to do that for lack of follow-up. That was supposed to be sometime this month. And with that, that's all I have.
All right. Thank you, Chief Hahn. City Administrator Brent Spear.
Good evening, and it's not bad batting cleanup because that makes my list much smaller. So we've got some good information out there. The two free little libraries have been relocated, so they're no longer in picture zone or in a place where somebody's going to hit their head sitting at the pool. So those have been done, and hopefully people can get out there and use those. I've been notified of some concrete work needs to be done as well as tile work at the pool, and we will address that after our busy season, and we do have money in the budget to hopefully do that. With the EDC, they should have a report tonight, but I'll report on that parking lot project that is continuing. It's at 2094 Clear Lake Road, and it's progressing very nicely. Got some good quality sidewalks going in that will be golf cart friendly and also pedestrian friendly. So look for that to be completed hopefully within the next week or so. Kind of dependent on a little bit of weather. Let's see. We did spend a lot of time this past week planning for what eventually became Namesdorp Berry. And what was frustrating with that, and I think everyone in this room can agree, is that they don't have a really good track on it. We spend a lot of time waiting, and that makes it really important for you as citizens, we as government employees and officials, to make sure that we're prepared in the event that we have to say, get out. And you'll also get a half page of that in the next Islander, so look forward to that. Put my voice with that, with those words of wisdom, but it really got our attention because by the time they calculated it could, had the potential to become a tropical storm, it was already too late for the state of Texas to change the traffic pattern and get us out of here. And when you think about stuff like that, we try to do everything as expeditiously as possible. That kind of got my attention. You need to be able to go when it's time to go. So. Keep that in the back of your mind or the forefront, depending on the time of year and what we're watching. Also, when you get your information, we get all of our information from the National Weather Service. Obviously, they're credentialed, but they're also located very close to us. So they're just down on 646. We have a good working relationship with forecasters and people that do that work, and we trust them. So. If you're looking at something on the internet and it's somebody that's doing a forecast from Chicago for this area, consider the source. Try to get a little closer to home. I think you'll get some better information. With the public works, if you've been up there to the other city owner, I guess it would be called the Farmers Market parking lot, that small structure or shed, it sustained some damage, had a lot of rot in it, and everything in it was ruined. That has been dismantled and has disappeared, so they got rid of that due to decay. The nautical-style lighting on Clear Lake Road, as you turn off of 2094, has been repaired. We had a few lights out that required some electronic ballasts and power supplies. I did find those, and I found them in all places. Germany, and ordered five of them and had them shipped here for the cost of one buying it here in the United States. So I think they were just clearing off their shelves. So they are in place, and they're working fine. Some good news, the city is saving some money on workman's compensation. Of course, that's subject to change next year, but we were re-rated, and it resulted in a savings next year of just over $5,000 on that premium. So it went down from $23,000 to $17,900. So that's good, and that's the benefit you have when you have people that work smart and don't get injured, and you know, use their personal protective equipment and so forth. One thing that I will I put it in the packet for council, but I will be bringing it up for discussion next time will be a review of the tattoo policy for employees. It specifies the size, and depending on how my shirt's right on me, I'm in violation of that policy. We have other employees as well. and I think there's maybe a better way of looking at that. We have some police officers that, have extensive tattooing, and honestly, I've never seen it because it's always covered. But you can imagine working in this environment, particularly wearing all that equipment and having to wear long sleeves. So trying to help them out a little bit and see if we can come to maybe some middle ground on that and just reference offensive tattoos. I did meet with FEMA representative today along with Kevin, and that was enlightening. That was pretty much a comprehensive review of our substantial damage cases, far beyond, basically. Any of the structures that were rebuilt and, all the related paperwork, including permitting and, you know, the internal paperwork that's created by our building official, building department. And I'd like to compliment Kevin. He did a very good job with that, and I think they were pleased today, and there may be some activity in the future. They may be driving around to take pictures of some of these structures and also some of the what we call low houses. You know, we want to be more proactive, and, so do they, and help get people up off the ground. So that's what they're working towards, and we're trying to assist them with that. We also have a couple things that we'll probably be working on. One will be, I think, a functional spreadsheet where we can get the base level elevation of any structure that's in the city. That was one of the things that they inquired about. We have all that information, but it's on individual pieces of paper under each property. So I think maybe we can get in there and make that happen. You've received your e-bike update, and a reminder to council, and just so the public knows, council is working on a combined strategic plan that is with the EDC as well as council members. I think it's important to involve people that are trying to generate and bring business to the city, and mesh that with vision for the city. So be doing a lot of work with that in the coming week, and we have a all-day kind of work session. No decisions will be made, but to talk about that direction, and that'll be on July 26th. It will be posted, and it'll take place here at the clubhouse. And just so you're aware, I'll be out of town Thursday through Sunday for my sister's wedding in Illinois. So I'm kind of looking forward to 80-degree weather. Yeah, it's all rain. Oh, is it heat? Okay.
Thank
Any
you,
questions?
Brent. Any questions?
No.
Thank you, Brent.
Thank you.
All right, staff report. Oh, sorry. Committee reports, roads and drainage.
All right. Alex Scanlon, I'm on the roads and drainage board or committee. We met last week. Present at our meeting was Cobb Finley, the city engineer. We met last week. Present at our meeting was Cobb Finley, the city engineer, rep from the EDC, and the city administrator. We discussed outstanding issues from the last project. Got a couple like the ditch at Narcissus and Forest on the southwest side. We're kind of come up with a solution for that in the near term since it's a little dangerous. And then we were working towards identifying roads for the 2020 project to get a little better idea of what we're working with. Terracon's going to be coming out to do some core samples on a select number of roads to take some of the guesswork out of it. And we'll be meeting, I think, early next quarter to kind of finalize our plan and see what our budget is going to let us do. That's all I have.
Thanks, Alex.
Thank you, Alex. Our waterfront compliance, anybody here? Okay, they did complete all their walkthroughs. They want to do one more this weekend with everybody together. Then they'll be bringing those violations to the city. Parks and pool?
Chris Richardson has been out of town. The Parks and Pool Committee chair has been out of town for family business. But she asked me to report that the committee continues to notify city administrator of issues, especially with the pool this season. There's always issues, right? Mm-hmm. So they're always in close contact with him, and he's been very responsive, and they're appreciative. Pool tags, lifeguards checking pool tags. It's interesting because my babysitter is one of our lifeguards, and in hearing everything from her perspective and then hearing citizens' perspective, it's keep in mind these are kids, and you know, be gentle with them. They're there just to CPR you. Don't give them a hard time. So, and finally, the flip-flop. With the dissolution of the landscape and beautification, we're trying to decide what to do with the flip-flop, be it black rocks to complement the yellow flip-flop, or perennial flowers, so working on that. And the Parks and Pool Committee also was instrumental in relocating the head-banging book boxes, as well as the picture obliterating book boxes in Deep Hole. So thank you, and that's Parks and Pool.
I saw a couple of y'all out there today at the flip-flops this morning, so I think a couple of y'all are in this room, so thank you to everyone out this morning.
Thank you. All right, thank you, Angie. Planning and zoning?
Yes, Mayor. Planning and zoning met back on July 9th, and in particular, we addressed that meeting the issuance of the new firm maps, the base flood being raised up at least 3 feet. The recommendation coming from the planning and zoning is to raise the maximum height from 42 feet to 45 feet for the residential areas to accommodate for this elevation. So while I'm up, also report on the Zoning Board of Adjustment. There's been no meeting since the last council meeting, so that's the report there.
What do you need from us to make that happen, the 42 to 45?
Well, the planning and zoning is making the recommendation. I think probably Kevin and Brett would need to amend the ordinance and then present it to council for approval. I think that would be the next step.
Excellent. Thank you for your work. Appreciate it.
That's that firm map goes into effect, I believe, August 15th.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So it would affect any new houses, anybody who's getting ready to build.
Or raise.
Mm-hmm.
Correct. And we've asked Kevin to go ahead and get that on the next council agenda. Mm-hmm. All right, next is Zoning Board of Adjustment.
He gave his update.
Oh, that too. Okay, sorry. Economic EDC? Anybody here? Mike? No? All right, no EDC. Civic Club? Teresa?
We had our freedom festival, which was a kid, well, that went down.
Thank you for that, the read aloud. And if you don't know, we've instituted, along with the new and improved library, once a month, we have one of the library caretakers or a resident read aloud to the children and also offer snacks and a craft. And this month, Peggy Wright's going to be reading with Bo, her dog, a book about a library dog. And so every month we're doing that. So thank you to the Civic Club. We were funding that ourselves. We're grateful.
Let me know when those happen so I can post on our page.
You have a question?
It's the third Sunday of the month at 2 p.m.
Thank you, Teresa, and thank you, Angie. All right, public comments. Matt, can you use a microphone, please?
I'm Matt Wiggins. I'm the new president of the Water Board. We're in charge of getting good water to your house and getting the bad water away from you. This is my second go-around as president of the Water Board. I was president 15 years ago, and we did a 10-year plan 15 years ago. And what I found out since I've gone back is that 15 years is not long enough. You got to plan way out for this stuff. It's like moving a ship in a small area takes a while to do anything. But I met with the Gulf Coast Water Authority Monday, and we've talked about what we need to do in the future to get everything we need for our three communities, being Kima, Clear Lake Shores, and Lazy Bend, and make sure we have enough water and sewer to take care of everything. We have plenty of sewer and plenty of opportunity for sewer. Water is a different ball game, and we're looking at some other ways to get water here through League City and some other places. So we're going to have enough water. It's going to take us a little while on some of this stuff, but we want to make sure that Kima and Clear Lake Shores still has a lot of, both of them have a lot of empty lots that have not been built on, and we're going, that's the priority is on our allocation of our connections is the city lots that we have in our communities. And then we'll go to the commercial stuff after that, and then we'll go outside the district. So we're working on all that. We're going to be in pretty good shape in about 6 or 8 months. But there, in the next water bill, you'll be getting my phone number in the water bill. This will be my number. If you see something like water running down the street or water running out of somebody's house or the lights on at one of the pump stations, text me, and we'll be right on it. Don't, just send a quick text, and we'll get right on it. But I just wanted to let y'all know that we're trying to figure all this stuff out. We're going to have plenty of water for Starfleet whenever that group gets their stuff done.
Thank you, Matt, and thanks for the phone number. I know sometimes we get that red light on some of the lift stations.
Yeah,
and
the number goes
nowhere. Yeah. Yes, Ken. Can you use a microphone, please? Or he can repeat the question if it's to Matt.
I just wanted to ask, what do y'all think about as far as rain recovery from our, rain gutters and any of that? I worry about how much water, of course, is going to come for our properties when we get 15 inches of rain. I was just wondering, is there anything we should start thinking about? I'm thinking about putting in a rain recovery because I'm putting new gutters in and working on my house. Is that anything y'all are interested in or what we should do?
We participate in a state project about saving water and using water and water conservation. And we do it mainly through the schools right now, but we're looking at virtually everything. We've looked at gray water, and what to do with it. And, we're a town of 3,800 people, and we just don't have the volume to do a whole lot of exotic things. But the water board's been managed pretty well over the years. I remember back when I first got elected, I think Clear Lake Shores had four of the five, and I ran, and John Scott was the president. Many of y'all probably remember him. He was a character, and so I get there and I said I went over to his house one afternoon. I said, "All right, what's the problem?" He goes, "Who said there was a problem?" And I said, "Well, Bill King says there was a problem." He goes, "Well, then it's not a problem." And another fellow that. From Kima that got elected to the board the same time I did, we went and had lunch about 3 weeks later. We can't figure out anything to do, so we just sat there like lumps on a dill pickle for a couple of years. So the water board is a, we're a utility. But in a small community, it becomes much more important. But we're trying to get enough water for our future, and we'll have it ready to go.
Nope. And we're going to cut that off at this point. Yep. Thank you, Matt. All right, any other public comments? Having none. Next, we'll go to number 9, old business discussion and possible action may be taken on the following items. This is item A, an ordinance of the City of Clear Lake Shores, Texas, amending Chapter 38, Flood Damage Prevention, Article 3, General Provisions, Section 38-62, basis for establishing the area of special flood hazard, Article 4, Administration, Section 38-92-9 and 10, duties and responsibilities of the floodplain administrator, Article 5, provisions for the flood hazard reduction, Section 38-122, specific standards 4-A, B, and C, manufactured homes, and 5, recreational vehicles of the Code of Ordinances of the City of Clear Lake Shores, Texas, by adopting, and there's another page, modification of the Chapter 38.
Mayor, I'll move to approve Ordinance 2019-05.
A second.
Amanda motion, Angie second.
So I have a question on this one. This is effective immediately?
That's what I would like to address.
Yeah, because it states in a different part in Section 3 that it's dated August 15th.
Our intent is to have that on August 15th. However, I think it's just a formatting. Keep typing. That was brought over, and normally they're passed immediately upon adoption. I would ask that maybe you revise that to the August 15th date. That is, that coincides with FEMA and the firm map changes, and when those go into effect, that's what we need to do. It also allows us to work with some commercial developers in the meantime to help develop some projects we're working on. At least one that I know of that it has a very tight timeline, and if it was passed immediately upon adoption tonight, I believe that opportunity would dissolve. So we want to give.
So we need to amend Section 10, the effective date, to say that it's effective August 15th, 2019.
Yes, if you can do that, that would help us
out. I'll amend my motion to approve with an amendment of Section 10, effective date of August 15th, 2019.
A second.
All right, we have a motion from Amanda to amend the motion with a second from Angie to take in effect August 15, 2019. All in favor? Any opposed? Unanimous. All right, item B, an ordinance of the City of Clear Lake Shores, Texas, amending Chapter 14, Building and Building Regulations, Article 2. Technical codes by adding Division 9, 2015 International Energy Conservation Code, Division 10, 2015 International Existing Building Code, Division 11, 2015 NFPA Life Safety Code, and Chapter 34 Fire Prevention Article 1 in general, Section 34-1, International Fire Code of the Code of Ordinance of the City of Clear Lake Shores, Texas, by adopting the modification of Chapter 14.
Make a motion to accept Ordinance 2019-06.
I'll second.
Angie Terrell made a motion. Jan Bailey second. Any discussion?
No.
Having none, all in favor? Unanimous. All right, new business number 10, consent agenda for items A through D.
I would like to pull item D and approve items A, B, and C.
I'll second that.
All right, Amanda made a motion to pull item D and consent agenda for items A through C, and then Jan Bailey second. All in favor?
All in favor?
Sorry.
Any opposed?
Trying to see
what's in there. All right, item D, discussion.
So item D is the minutes from the last council meeting. I'm trying to find it. If I remember correctly, it didn't list me as being absent.
Mm-hmm.
Is that correct?
Yeah, that's correct. I think. Yeah.
Yeah, so I think we just need to amend to include my absence.
You blew your own whistle.
There was something else in there. I can't find them now. Sorry.
You have the minutes.
I'm sorry. That's the only thing I saw. Sorry.
There was something that had time of a.m. and p.m.
Let me help you.
Maybe not on this one. Okay. That's it.
Okay.
All right. So we amend those minutes. Have a motion.
I will move to amend to list me as absent.
All right.
A second.
Andy second. All in favor? Unanimous. All right, number 11, council business discussion and possible action may be taken on the following items. Item A is the renewal or possible termination of the existing EMS contract and approval to proceed with future contract or interlocal agreement to provide EMS services. So with this, just a little bit of discussion, we have a current contract that's going from $30,000 with an increase to $83,000. It's in your work package packet. In addition to that, we've had a proposal from Galveston County with a rate of, I actually have confirmation from them of $35,000, and I believe $165,000 was going to be charged to Kima, and Lazy Bend would be rolled in with no charge. And then also, Chief of the Fire Department has also submitted a proposal from the Kima Fire Department. All of that was included in your packet, and I'd be available to answer any questions you may have.
So can we make a motion to discuss and then...
Sure.
Yeah, so I will move to discuss renewal or possible termination of existing EMS contracts.
I will second that.
Amanda Fenwick to discuss and Jan Bailey.
Okay. It's a big one. I'm not sure where to start with
yeah.
this one. I cannot look my neighbors in the face and justify a 64% increase for emergency services for the same level of care
Absolutely.
That we have been receiving, just due to the fact that other cities have dropped out and Clear Lake Shores, Kima, and the remaining are asked to pick up the excess. I cannot justify that. So for me, that leaves Galveston and Kima. My question with Kima's proposal, or Galveston's proposal, is why does Galveston get Kima's ambulance as a part of their service to us? Why do they like commandeer that ambulance? I'm not understanding that.
Well, and why is Kima also responsible to pay to outfit?
Yes, I don't understand.
For this purpose. Yeah, it's a good question, and I asked that question last night at the ESB meeting. Chief, feel free to jump in, and we didn't have an answer on that. That was something that Terry Gale asked, because another ESB member, David Zinski, who's on, who's a member of the fire department, asked another several other questions regarding staffing and reporting structure and, you know, what happens when they take over the fire department and leave it a mess and all kinds of other things. And Mayor Gale asked for him to compile a list of questions that needed to be addressed in the negotiations with Galveston County. And so those two questions were ones that I asked to have added to that list as well.
And so you're telling me that that question had not previously been asked?
I asked the question last night.
Before
and
you had
correct,
asked
Correct. And,
so
and I was told at our ESB meeting last night by those who have been in discussions with Galveston County that would be a discussion point come time to negotiate a contract.
Right, as part of
right.
the interlocal agreement.
Right. And that's also to note that the assets that Kima Volunteer Fire Department actually, they're owned by WCID 12, correct?
The vehicles are, not
yeah.
all the assets.
Right.
The vehicles are.
Yeah. Right, that's what I meant.
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah, okay.
The ambulance that would be
right.
used.
That's right.
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah, so the proposal is to move that asset over to Galveston County while they provide services. There's discussion between Clear Lake Shores and Kima that down the road that we feel that we could actually move the services into Kima. That's just from a mayor standpoint.
And I asked that,
yeah,
go ahead, sorry.
But starting off from that standpoint, I don't think it's achievable within the 2 months. So one thing to look at is, and what Kima did too, is one was to go ahead and, the concern is if we don't give notice to CLEMPSI to terminate, mm-hmm. then if we have dual service, we'll be getting dual charges during
right.
that time.
That's right.
So we could go ahead and move forward with terminating the contract with CLEMPSI and still have over the next 2 months to come up with the new service. And that's just throwing that out there.
And I think as part of our planning discussions that we're having now, from a strategic plan standpoint, we need to probably figure out what our long-term goal is with public service for our citizens. Is it going to be to stay with Galveston County? Is it going to be to bring that internally with the fire department? And I mean, public safety is probably number one top priority responsibility
mm-hmm.
for us. And so we need to, in my opinion, have that conversation, what that means. Because I asked that question to the ESB last night of what our plan is long term, and again, it was, well, we'll figure it out. Mm-hmm. I'm not a figure it out along the way kind of person. So I don't disagree with you, Mayor. I think we probably do need to have some service in the interim and provide Chief the opportunity to hire the people that he needs to hire and get the equipment and assets that he needs to have in order to provide the level of service, if not better, that we're accustomed to or that we have currently.
I'm just going to say there's nothing that I would like more than to have KEMA, Clear Lake Shores Volunteer Fire Department, also serve us as our emergency medical service. You're right there. And if I need you, I love that you're right there. That being said, is there a way to do a month-by-month with another provider, Galveston, while KEMA is able to ramp up their service for us?
So right now the discussions is they would do a 3-year contract with the true-ups every once a year, and that's what they're offering at this time. We reached out to City of League City, and they basically turned in a no bid because their services are under their amount that they need to protect their city citizens right now. So they're a truck down and probably about 6 personnel, so they did not want to look into coming over and handling Clear Lake Shores. And then also that brings up a little bit of a problem as far as dispatching. I think it could be overcome, but you have KEMA coming out for fire, but then you have medical for Clear Lake Shores.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And that was just, I saw that as just a little bit of difficulty.
Mm-hmm. And the word dispatch triggered my brain as well. Chief, do we have a plan in place to establish a dispatch, a 911 calls KEMA Volunteer Fire Department and EMS, if we would choose to go with you as our EMS provider? How do we get you 911?
It would have to roll over from Galveston County. What happens now is when there's a 911 call here, Clear Lake Shores, it goes to county, and then county transfers it to KEMA,
mm-hmm.
KEMA dispatch. So there's a 911 here with the police department. You know, it goes to the county, and then it goes to KEMA for our dispatch. I don't know how the EMS dispatch is going to work. There's still several things that need to be worked out on this, but I don't know how it's going to work out as far as that goes. But historically, I don't know if it would change from going to the county and the county referring it to KEMA dispatch for us.
And do you have an idea? I know this is new, and this is kind of last minute. I know you wish you would have had more time, I'm sure. But do you have a rough idea of how long it would take KEMA to roll out the details that we need, or roll out details and amp up the service to provide us with service? How long would that take from?
Well, we're currently in the provider license process at this time to get our provider license. We have to have the provider license first, and then we would the personnel, you know, that's it. And the idea behind ours is it would be run with part-time personnel to avoid the cost of benefits of full-time employees for EMS to staff with a minimum paramedic and EMT. And we're getting the staff, the equipment, the majority of the equipment is already there. I mean, one of the biggest capital expenses would be to buy a second ambulance, because there's PMs that need to be done, there is mechanical difficulties, heaven forbid if there's a wreck, or if there's one ambulance is already out, if we have the staffing to staff that second ambulance, that's the other portion of that. So to give you, a time, it's unfortunately it's the licensing that takes so long.
I understand.
And we just got our medical director hired, and then mm-hmm. he's approved protocols, and it's kind of on a as finished basis, and that goes to the state. And then so one of the things that we do have to work out with this is if that asset is used by Galveston County, we will no longer as a fire department be able to apply for our provider license. So we're looking at ways to try to work on that. I don't know what the near answer is, so I'm waiting. Thursday we're supposed to have a meeting to kind of get things together and see if there's a way to maybe see if Galveston can provide an ambulance, and mm-hmm. I don't know.
Wow.
So it's kind of tough.
Sure.
Dan and Amanda, y'all were both there. I think there needs to be an answer, and I want to assure the public you will not be without emergency medical services, period. There is no question about whether an ambulance is going to be here. We will get it worked out and do what's best for the communities. There's just some things that need to be understood and processed before we were able to roll out EMS from our station. So.
And we have mutual aid agreements in place.
We do have mutual aid agreements in place, yes.
So how long is it before you'd get the license, you think?
I'm hoping. We just finished the protocol process. Now it goes into the state licensing, and then we have to get with the state on that so we can get our Medicare and Medicaid approval numbers. So maybe January, and that's a guess. These things just don't go that quick. And we are going as quickly as possible. The new medical director we picked up is just fabulous. Really gung-ho. He's fire-based EMS. He did some of his internship in Dallas with DFD, Dallas Fire Department. So we're working on that, trying to get it done as quickly as possible.
Right.
Do you have to have the Medicaid numbers before you turn in the application, or you've already turned in the application?
No, ma'am. That'll be afterwards.
Okay.
So
all your insurance billing will be taken care of afterwards.
For the whole thing.
Yeah.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay.
Yeah, just getting the certificate from the state. You know, mm-hmm. That's what the protocols. They do an inspection of the vehicle. They look at the equipment. They look at the medical director, the training program, the QAQC.
Okay.
There's a whole list of things on that application that just time-consuming. Mm-hmm.
But if I'm understanding properly, if Galveston acquires WCID 12's asset in the form of your box, you can't do anything?
No, ma'am.
Right.
And that
well
is negotiable.
Well, that's what's currently being said right now. I think there's other things in work.
Yeah. And I don't know what else
protocols.
In work with that, so I don't know.
There was discussion that Galveston County would allow your firefighters to be able to work for Galveston County.
Yes, sir. There is that discussion.
Right. So those are all little things that need to be worked out in the interlocal agreement. And that's what's being in work right now. I have a copy. Right now it's in the lawyer's hands to make sure the wording's correct and stuff, and before it all goes out to council.
So, Mayor, in your discussions that you've had, it's a three-year deal with Galveston County. There's no option to do a year by year?
Well, you could always terminate early.
Is there a penalty for that?
Right. Well,
yeah.
There's like a substantial one?
Yeah, I don't know.
No, there wasn't any substantial. It's basically, it's a yearly contract. They wanted it 3 years to set the terms.
A three-year commitment.
For a commitment from both sides. One, Kima. If you notice, they're paying most of the expense.
Right.
Mm-hmm. Divided by the numbers, it's not very favorable for Kima, and we want to stay quiet on our side because
mm-hmm.
we're getting it for $35,000.
Right.
And I think that breaks down to $265 per person.
Which is better than the current proposal from our current provider.
Right.
So,
right.
So that brings up the same thing. You could stay with the current provider and have that higher expense or go with Galveston County. And then you also have mm-hmm. Kima going with Galveston County. You have other places with Clemcy, so our rates are even go up more. You have Pasadena that's going out, Seabrook, and Mud 55, I think,
mm-hmm.
is going
yes.
out.
Mm-hmm.
So,
that's right.
So, just from my standpoint, I know y'all had
mm-hmm.
some other discussions, but I feel confident in terminating the contract with Clemcy.
Mm-hmm.
We need to do that. I feel like we need some more information on what this contract is going to look like with Galveston County, what the responsibility from the Kima Volunteer Fire Department is going to be, staff-wise, asset-wise, et cetera, I feel like that we're going to have to go that route and let Chief have the time that he needs to staff and do what he needs to do, but I want to see what the county comes back with. And I also heard that it still needs to go in front of Commissioner's Court. It went first round
Thursday.
And they need to review it again.
Yeah, and everything from that was favorable.
Yeah.
They didn't, and none of the commissioners saw any issues.
Mm-hmm. And I liked the Galveston County proposal. I thought it was strong, and I think it's fair, and especially like what you said, we're getting a good deal compared to what Kima's paying. I just don't want Kima to be boxed out in the future, because I think that would be a great opportunity. And the ambulance, I know it's WCID 12's but that going to Galveston just seems like a really tough position to put our fire department in, because they can't go any further. So I would just ask that that's heavily negotiated.
Yeah,
I believe the intentions are to eventually get to go to Kima. It's just that this interim, we've got to have something in place, and Galveston had the best offer for us. Plus, it was, you know, they're able to have funding from the county, which
right.
our taxes pay for in the first place. So we get some of our taxes back from that, which is important. And also, I did have some additional information somewhere. They have 86 employees. I didn't have that on my other chart. 16 ambulances and 6 stations, as an FYI.
So they could use their ambulances and not ours.
So they would be using the Kima box here, and then they would have, they have 2 boxes down in Baycliff, of which one's a 24/7. And they have, you know, within a 10-minute response.
A box is an ambulance. I found that out.
I mean, would it be possible to have a box here and a box in Baycliff, and then ours is free to...
They felt really ready to entertain that.
Good.
It was
so that we wouldn't have to use ours.
I think there's a little bit of a logistics issue with having the box or ambulance at Kima Fire Station. And that has to be worked out yet, too. We've
mm-hmm.
been looking at possibly doing some renovations at the Kima Fire Station.
Yeah,
there's a lot of things. And a lot of information. Just move very quickly.
Yes.
And we'll do what's best. So we'll do what we can to keep everybody informed. The one thing I'd like is the more available ambulances up here, the better. Because they're summertime. We know what summertime is. We know what a major accident on any of these roads will do. And there has been more than one occasion where we've had more than just one call drop. So that's the thing that we want to keep in mind.
Are we ready for a motion, or do you guys need to discuss more? Motion to?
Motion to table.
But don't we want to move forward with?
Oh, yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, we are ready for I'm ready for a motion for
right.
Tennessee.
Yeah.
Okay.
I say that.
So calling a motion.
Sorry, I need to make sure I word it correctly. So I will make a motion to terminate our existing EMS contract with Clear Lake Emergency Medical Corps.
One second.
All right, I have a motion from Amanda, a second from Andy to terminate the existing FLEMC EMS contract. All in favor? Any opposed? Unanimous.
And then we just need to table the topic of
the
interlocal agreement until we have
table the topic of the interlocal agreement for
or
other EMS services for Clear Lake Shores. All right, item B, discussion only, annual Citizen Volunteer of the Year Award, Councilwoman Fenwick.
So this is something I've been thinking about for a while, and I wanted to get council's kind of feelings on. We have a lot of apathy in this city about volunteering, and I'm not saying that giving some award to somebody is going to make a difference, but you know, I've looked at what some other cities do with regards to how they recognize and thank their citizens and people who volunteer in their communities, specifically on their committees. And so I thought, what if we do something on an annual basis? It might look something like nominations are due in October or November. There's a team of 2 council members, 2 staff members, 2 citizens that review nominations based off criteria, different weighted options for whether or not they serve on a committee, how long they've served. And then we, you know, invite top 2 or top 3 or, you know, something to our annual holiday dinner, and we award our Citizen of the Year with a nice award. So it'd be a small budget impact, you know, additional 2 or 4 people at our holiday party and the cost of an award. And I don't know, I just think we have a lot of people, many who are on multiple committees, we have a lot of new faces, and so it might be an incentive to get them involved in our community and what we do. And so if it's something that we think we might want to look at, I'm happy to put together a full proposal. I didn't want to go through all of that, you know, but I just wanted to discuss and get thoughts and feedback from y'all.
Have you looked at cities that have done it, and what is that what that looks like?
Yeah, so I looked at I've looked at League City, I looked at Seabrook, and then the Clear Creek Education Foundation also has a volunteer city. I don't know what they call it, but and a lot of the criteria is the same. It's you know what committees are how they've served their community. They don't necessarily have to serve in League City on a committee, but there's extra weight given to someone who does serve on a committee. You know, how long have they served in that capacity? You know, what they've contributed, because it's one thing to say I've served on a committee, but what have you actually contributed? Mm-hmm. And they can be self-nominations or they can be nominated by others. And then they have a team of people, again, staff members from the city. It's a good way for our staff to get involved also in what we do, elected officials, and then citizens. So, you know, they're being elected by or represented by their peers. So just a thought.
I like not only the idea, but I like the people that are nominated that are serving on multiple committees and are involved in a lot of things. That puts a spotlight on those things that they're doing. So,
right.
I didn't even know that there was a whatever committee.
Right.
And so
right.
That would be advantageous too, I think.
And I would just want to make sure it didn't become a popularity vote.
Absolutely.
Right. Waiting
right.
to several
yes.
categories.
Exactly.
Yeah.
And then I think you rotate the people
yeah.
every year that review
yeah.
and select so that it's not the same two council members or two staff members every year.
Mm-hmm.
You're getting different input.
And the prior
every year.
Citizen of the Year could be also
yeah.
on that board.
I think that's
mm-hmm.
great. So
that's
if it's something
idea.
That we
that's
think we
yeah.
Yeah, yeah, that we like, then I can go and put together kind of a full proposal and look at some sort of score sheet and criteria and so on and so forth.
I think it's fantastic.
Thank
yeah, thank
yeah.
you.
Cool.
Yeah.
Awesome. Thanks.
All right. That completes item B. Item C, discussion only. Boat Ramp Special Committee recommendation, Councilwoman Terrell.
Boat Ramp Committee, just to give you a little history, with the 146 construction, a lot of the boat ramps in the area were closed, and that led to some concern that our boat ramp might start getting overutilized. So we as a council tried to be proactive with that and see what we could do as far as parking to not block the East Shore Loop or have, you know, big, huge boats barreling down our streets as a result of the boat ramps being closed and ours being used more. One of those proactive things that we did was we erected the signs that are on the East Shore Loop now that say no parking. We based those signs upon an ordinance that we currently have in effect, but the signs don't truly say what the ordinance says, which made enforcement challenging for our police department. The ordinance had to do with trailers and vehicles not blocking the road for emergency vehicles. And when that got brought to our attention, the other thing that got brought to our attention was the signs that currently are in the boat ramp that say parking only for vehicles with trailers attached. And we started wondering, well, where did that come from? So we started scouring the ordinances, and because we expect them to enforce this, but unfortunately there wasn't anything there for them to enforce. So then Mayor Otten decided, well, maybe we should take a look at this and make sure that all of our ordinances match up with our signs and match up with what we think we're doing so that our police department can properly enforce this for us if it should become an issue with our boat ramp going forward, the other ones being closed. So Mayor Otten put together a special committee, two citizens, two police officers, and two council members. We had a meeting, a kickoff meeting, a few hours, and we started brainstorming all of these things, and then subsequent emails ensued to help us identify what the problems are at the boat ramp and what our solutions are, or our ideas for solutions. The reason that we're bringing it to council tonight is because we want to see if we're going in the right direction. We don't want to start jacking with ordinances and making edits and doing things that we as a council, as representatives of our folks, don't want done. So I just want to review. I just want to run this by you guys and let you know where we're at. If you like it, we'll go forward and we'll start doing ordinance amendments and what we need to do. But just in your packet, you'll see the five issues that the special committee identified, the first being Shell Bottom Park and the boat ramp signage indicating the vehicles for trailers. Vehicles with trailers only is not substantiated by any city ordinance. Enforcement is impossible because of that. The second issue, Shell Bottom Park, boat ramp hours, it says no parking from 12 to 5 a.m. are different from the other parks on the island. That's no parking 12 to 6 a.m. Essentially, they're closed 12 to 6. Shell Bottom's closed 12 to 5. The police officers on the committee said that actually is an issue, and it makes it confusing for them, confusing for our visitors, so we identified that as a challenge. The third challenge of the five boat launch and retrieval ends at 10 p.m. per Ordinance 66-140 and the posted sign. That's 2 hours before our park closes at midnight. Fireworks don't start until 9:30 if they're on time, at 9:45 sometimes. That makes retrieval of your boat after fireworks impossible. So we just think that that should be worded differently and maybe married up with the hours of the park. We're not sure why that's there. We couldn't find a reason for that. So we identified that as an issue. Issue 4 of 5, the no parking signs that we did erect on East Shore don't indicate exactly what vehicles can and cannot park between those signs, and also what vehicles we're talking about. We based it on an ordinance that talks about vehicles with trailers, but we were expecting it to impact people with cars. And it has, but it's not exactly right, and it's not enforceable. We can't tow these people when we don't have anything backing that up. We don't want them parking all over the street and impeding progress, but or impeding emergency vehicles, yeah. But we can't really base it on those signs because it's not based on a good ordinance. And the fifth issue, the golf cart parking over there, we noticed that there is no ordinance dedicating that as golf cart parking, and there also is no sign. We know it's golf cart parking. Our new visitors don't. So they could just pull their truck on up there and park on our little our golf cart area if they want to. There's nothing that the cops could do about that. We have no ordinance. We have no sign. So these are the five issues we identified in Shell Bottom and the boat ramp. And if you look on the next page, our suggestions, number one, we'd like to remove all the signs from Shell Bottom and the boat ramp that indicate parking is for vehicles with trailers only, as well as the fact that the boat ramp is closed at 10 p.m., and also all of the no parking signs along East Shore that aren't really based on anything. We'd like to take all of that out. We'd like to replace it with one nice sign at the entrance to the park, similar to what you've seen in other parks, Clear Lake Park. Jay Fenwick is one of our committee members. He's gone to 28 local parks and taken pictures of all of the signs. And they have really nice signs, and just one really nice sign giving the rules of the park. So the rules what we are proposing are, some are based on current ordinances, some would need an ordinance revision. First, Shell Bottom Park closed 12 midnight to 5 a.m., and you'll see highlighted in red there, that would require an ordinance change. Mm-hmm. And we are proposing that all the parks have the same operating hours and be closed midnight to 5 a.m. The other parks, again, are closed until 6. Let's make them all midnight to 5. That makes it easier for our police to enforce. Use the boat ramp at your own risk. It doesn't say that anywhere, but we're not responsible for them being not so smart at the boat ramp, so we want to add that in there. No fishing from the pier, that's a current ordinance that we do have in place. Again, these are all items that we'd like listed on our nice sign as the folks enter the boat ramp. No swimming, that's a current ordinance in place. No firearms, fireworks, current ordinance in place. This next item would require an addition. What we found is, let me tell you this first, no parking on unpaved areas adjacent to city streets such that vehicle or trailer would encroach upon the street itself. Vehicles are subject to tow. If towed, call this number. That's the other thing we found. If we tow people, they have no idea where their vehicle is. And it's no one's fault. It doesn't say in there anywhere that we have to have that number posted, but we really need to. So, again, that takes care of the encroaching upon the street. We're actually adding it to an ordinance, and we're posting it on there that this is the way Clear Lake Shores works. Don't park so you're hanging out into the street. We need to get by. And the next one, do not drive any vehicle in the park except on paved roads or park in any area other than designated parking areas. This one is an interesting Pandora's box because what we found was the definition of vehicle includes golf carts. So really, when we have our golf carts in the parks, when we have our golf carts on the waterfront leases, that's illegal, really. They could come and arrest us all, and we'd all just go to jail and have a big party there. So we need to fix that because we do want the golf carts to be able to park in the parks and on the waterfronts and in Jarbo. So we would suggest modifying 66-137 to exclude golf carts from the definition of vehicle and also add the definition that we have in another ordinance, 78-175, into that list of definitions so we know exactly who's allowed to park in the park and who can't. Clean up after your pet, that's currently in existence. All pets must be on a leash, currently in existence. Police for non-emergencies, yada, 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 give them a number. sorry, but we thought that that was a good idea for them to at least know who to call.
Mm-hmm.
Again, if anything happens, 911, of course, but we wanted to list a non-emergency contact number, and you guys won, yay. So there you go. And finally, we have this amazing new website in Clear Lake Shores. Amanda and the Communications Committee were a huge part of that. And what we'd like to do is, at the bottom of the sign, put a reference to that website for a complete list of park rules, please go to www.clearlakeshores-texas.gov. That not only gives all of our rules, that gives our ordinances, that when they say, oh, there's no sign that says, yeah, it actually does say, and you want to wade through all our ordinances and find it because the cops know it and they're arresting you for a reason, and now they'll know what the reason is too because the ordinances are right there in front of them. In addition, we could also put any information that we wanted to add for their boating safety or what have you. Amanda has some interesting ideas for what that could look like with the link to the website. She's the communications guru. Add a sign with boating safety adjacent to the actual ramp itself. Jay identified many, many ramps that have these boating safety signs, mostly check your safety equipment. What were some other things, Jay? We just talked about this. Safety equipment.
Life jackets.
Fire extinguishers. And the cool thing is that Texas Parks and Wildlife pays for that sign. And also the other cool thing is the other sign we want to have is a Coast Guard sign telling us where we can't go, all the restricted areas that maybe our visitors don't know because maybe they're not such avid boaters and they just have enough money to buy a boat but not enough sense to use it. The Coast Guard, that's probably wrong to say, isn't it? This is recorded. Great.
Check truth.
Yeah. The Coast Guard also will offer a sign like that adjacent to our boat ramp. So again, we can give them some safety information, give some Clear Lake Shores, some what?
MARSAC 1, whatever the hell that is.
Oh, yeah, the restricted. MARSAC 1 restricted areas. It lists those in a graphic form that even everybody can understand and see it and not go there. So just more visitor friendly, not only aligning ourselves with ordinances, but welcoming our visitors. Don't park on our streets, but you're welcome, and here's all our ordinances that you have to follow along with. And finally, there's been a lot of suggestion with the boat ramp. Should we privatize it? Should we not? We've done extensive research. We can privatize the boat ramp. What that would look like, though, I'm not sure that we would all want to get into that. The reason that we were talking about privatizing it is because we were worried about this influx of visitors. Patrick and Linda, you may have a different take on this, but from my vantage point personally, I'm right there at the boat ramp where they all are. And with the exception of a few yahoos, most of the folks are nice. They want to do the right thing. They don't know what the right thing is because we don't tell them other than pick up after your dog and make sure you don't retrieve your boat after 10 p.m.
But
they want to do the right thing. They want to park in the right area. I have people asking me all the time, I don't know where to park. I don't want to get in your driveway. So they're trying. I haven't seen a lot of evildoers come to the boat ramp that would necessitize privatizing it to Clear Lake Shores residents. Texas Parks and Wildlife, GLO, we're all consulted. Thank you, Jay. He did extensive research on this. We could do this for less than $500 a year, or less than $200 a year, payment to Texas Parks and Wildlife, privatizing, in addition to paying taxes on any memberships to GLO, to any taxes on any memberships that we would sell to our private boat ramp. The challenge in our private boat ramp comes in is that it has to be managed either by an HOA, oh no, we don't want that, or by a separate entity that is an LLC. Plaza 10 came up in our minds as an LLC that possibly could manage that. That's not going to work. That's not allowed. We would have to set an outside entity, not us, would be managing our private boat ramp. And that could pose a lot of challenges for us. Do we have the membership fees to maintain the boat ramp? How are we going to block the boat ramp off? We're still only going to have minimal parking, so even if you paid your $50, $100, whatever the membership would be, you're still not going to get a parking lot or a parking space if you don't get there early. It's first come, first serve at the boat ramp. So we just didn't see that was really a legitimate way to go. The benefits did not outweigh the downsides to that. So what we looked at instead was beefing our boat ramp up and making it Mac Daddy via Texas Parks and Wildlife grants. They have grants that are matchable. See, they pay 75%, and then we pay 25%. We pay the upfront cost. They reimburse us. I've given you guys actually what the grant application looks like and what it can pay for. It can pay for a plethora of things, but most exciting to me was a parking lot improvement, possible additional parking. If they can pay for land acquisition, if we did see land that we could acquire, a lot or something near the boat ramp that we could use for additional parking, the grant could be used for that. It could be used for lighting. It could be used for making our boat ramp nice, and we don't have to outlay all of that cost. The disadvantage with the grant is that we cannot privatize it for the next at least 20 years. We are locked in then to being a public facility for all the people to use. But like I said, they've been using it nicely. It hasn't been bad, really. But we're locked into that for the next 20 years. So we, as a committee, are recommending we do not privatize it, and we do pursue the grant via the EDC grant writer, perhaps.
Mm-hmm. Galveston County.
Galveston County, yeah. And that we are in the application process now. I know our sales tax is down this year. I'm not sure that this year is the appropriate year to do this. I just don't want to privatize us and get us knocked out of this for a subsequent year that it might be applicable for, and that's why we as a committee are recommending that. So I just want to get your feedback. I want to see if we're going in the direction that you guys are behind. Do you want us to start making the changes and bring it to you for a vote, or is there something that you want us to do differently?
Well, I think that the changes that you guys have identified are definitely necessary. It is confusing when you go and look at a sign on where you can park and when you can't park, and is it 10 o'clock or is it midnight? So I think those are quick and easy fixes that definitely need to take place. You guys did a lot of work in this. You know, the golf cart parking thing, do we have an ordinance that says it at sunset, at sundial?
Unfortunately, in all of our parks, which includes all of the parks, but plus the waterfront, that's also considered a park. No, we're not allowed to park our golf carts on any of those. So we're going to address that. But there's a lot of things that we found that this led us into,
yeah.
And we don't want to get into that right now, other than adding golf cart or excluding golf cart from the vehicle definition. But we want to get into to fixing the other things that we found that were wrong as well.
Mm-hmm.
But, yeah, technically we can't park in any of our parks or our waterfront.
But you have on your recommendation adding a sign that says golf park cart parking only. So
right. So
that's confusing.
Understand. So what we would do is we would allow golf cart parking in the parks officially by amending that ordinance. And then we would put the golf cart parking in Shell Bottom at that brick area.
So that's a 66-138 ordinance change.
So would you add that to the thing to have that as an exception to have designated
right.
golf
yeah,
cart parking?
Yeah, 66-137 has all the definitions of vehicles and all of that. So we would add golf cart as an exception. We would include the definition that Clear Lake Shores has of a golf cart found in 78-175. We would take that definition, exclude it from vehicle, thus allowing all golf carts to park in all parks, including waterfront, boat ramp, all of those.
But then
legally.
You need to have one for the specific area, like down at...
Yeah, then one for
right.
the specific area, so our visitors
and,
would know, like Deep Hole, that
yeah.
this is golf cart parking only.
Right,
because
we have a ton of signs.
Yeah,
so we just, need to make
just
sure
one more
our
there
sign
in Shell Bottom.
What our ordinance says.
So we
exactly.
need an ordinance for Sunset and...
For Sundial...
And,
Deep Hole
yeah,
and Shell Bottom.
Everywhere that we have golf cart parking, we
yes.
technically,
golf
we
cart
really do
sign.
Need an
if,
ordinance that says...
If it's golf cart only.
Right. And that would marry up what we do with
right.
what our paperwork says we do.
A lot of places put, like, the ordinance number underneath, too, in
yeah.
small text.
That's a great idea. And that's really what we were getting to by referencing the Clear Lake Shores website, but I love it even more that
yeah,
we put the ordinance right there.
Ordinance,
it'll
whatever, and then you list the website, and they go
or
online, and they... We can take them... Well, but not if we're doing city ordinance. If we're just
yeah.
talking about city ordinance and just direct them... Right.
So what Jay just said is when we direct them to our website, it's going to be -texas.gov/parks.
Right.
To bring
so
us to
right.
all the rules.
So that would be at the big signs, but I'm
right.
talking
the little
smaller
signs.
That's what I'm talking about, too.
The
smaller
number.
Signs, you have the ordinance, and you can list the website,
yep.
and they can
right.
go find it.
Right.
One thing I would also like you to consider is the term golf cart isn't inclusive of all the vehicles that are used in this city and potentially could be used in the city and parked in those areas.
Motorcycles.
So, you know, they have, there are some ways to define, sometimes they're referred to as slow-moving vehicles because they're not able to get up to a, you know, a highway speed.
Mm-hmm.
So,
that's a good point.
Might need to be looked at as well.
That's a good point.
That's a good point because our definition in 78-175, golf cart is a motor vehicle that has no less than three wheels, has a maximum speed of between 15 to 25 miles per hour, and is manufactured primarily for the operation on golf courses.
Yeah.
Yours isn't, so we would need to. You gonna take that bad boy on a golf course? That's awesome.
It's an easy.
So
go,
would we need to amend it then, based on that? Do you want
to? I think
well,
you need
also
to.
There's also been a change.
Yeah. So Texas legislation passed a new law this year, HB 1548, that addresses the other vehicles that are allowed to be on the roadways now. And with that, we're going to have to update our ordinances to allow that for off-highway vehicles, providing they have a license plate. House Bill 1548.
Yep. Okay. How do we miss that one?
Yes, but it's $10. At the registration where you do your motor vehicle registration. It's for a different type of car. It's for an off-highway vehicle. That's something that was left out on the 85th legislation, and they messed up, and so they went back and fixed it because a lot of the four-wheel drive vehicles couldn't ride on the streets, and so that allows that now. No.
No.
Just the off-road vehicle. It's one particular type.
Off-highway vehicles.
Yes.
Yes.
They've classified a golf cart as a slow-moving vehicle in Texas Penal Code, so it's all good.
Yeah, we're good.
Yeah.
So far what I'm hearing is add the ordinance on the sign for the golf cart parking and create a golf cart parking ordinance. And adjust the definition for golf cart.
I mean, I think you need to do all five recommendations, honestly.
In addition to what you're,
I think they're all solid. I love the idea of applying for a grant.
Yes.
It's not something that we have done regularly. I think we have a good case. Assuming we get a good grant writer, grant writing is very specific, but from what I understand from previous conversations with our previous mayor, the county EDC or economic development people would be willing to help us with that. We need to move on it because the deadline's October and it's almost August.
Can we direct Charles to be in charge of reaching out to who he needs to reach out to as a representative of our EDC? Or how do
president.
We...
City administrator.
Brent can do it.
So Brent, that would be on you. Okay.
And that's just something we need to consider in the budget next year and have some more conversations around that because it is a budget impact.
It
but
is.
When you look at the ROI on it, I'd rather spend some money there than perhaps elsewhere.
Okay.
And before we can write a grant, we need to know what we can spend and what we want.
Right.
Right.
And
mm-hmm.
so that's kind of the cart before the horse.
Yeah.
At this point.
And so that's a conversation probably Angie, you and
internally
the
committee here.
Yeah.
Okay.
So only one other or two other concerns I had with about the whole if towed call such and such number.
Uh-huh.
Just from a state standpoint, there is no requirement from that.
Absolutely.
For a city to have that. And so
mm-hmm.
if that number changes, that's a cost.
I wanted that to be our non-emergency number, like
okay.
if like call dispatch so they can maybe track down where their car is. Not necessarily a tow company because, that, like you said, we don't have to do that.
Right.
I thought that could be our non-emergency number, so the chick that's out there in her swimming suit that had her car towed needs to know who
so
to call.
So we just need to make sure there's no additional cost to them calling off hours to our dispatch.
Okay.
I think that if our police department tows a vehicle, do they draw a case number, incident number? There's a call for service number that's associated with that. They tell dispatch that they're towing XYZ car from this location, and they know the towing company. It makes sense to put the dispatch number in there because they have the records,
good.
And whoever's carrying that in that non-emergency number may not have that readily available to them. So I'd say point them right back to
dispatch.
And if we're doing our jobs right in the field and calling it in and getting a call for service number, an incident number, whatever they refer to it as, they have a record in their computer of what, where that vehicle was, what kind of vehicle it was, what the plate was, and where it went. And
okay.
So just send them there, and we get completely out of it.
Right, and I just wanted to make sure it was clear that we don't need the signs like you have in other...
Correct.
Other,
we're not contracting.
Contracting.
Right.
And department stores and when your vehicle gets towed and stuff like that.
That's posting on private property.
Private property, right.
And we're not private property.
And the other recommendations where you're adding the sign adjacent to the actual ramp itself, possibly from the Texas Parks and Wildlife to include their line and string container systems.
Oh, yeah.
Oh.
Mm.
Because there's none
idea.
Down there.
Yeah.
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 Yeah, that's cool.
Sea grant? Okay.
I will in a second. I'm making sure all discussion is complete.
Chief Cook, do you have anything to add? Okay.
Any further discussion from council?
This is great, you guys. I know it was a whole lot of work, and so thank you to everybody who participated, Jay and Mike and Angie, you and I think Chrissy were on that committee, and then Sergeant Bueller and Officer Sawyer were on that, and I understand they were provided some good input, so thank you for your work.
Thank
and
you.
I'd like to ditto that. Thank you for that.
Thank
okay,
you.
We'll be back.
Ms. Mikowski.
Patrick Michalski, 126 East Shore. I just would ask, apologize I wasn't able to make it to the meeting, but was there any discussion brought up with the issues of boaters coming on shore and then having drunk all day long, having to use the restroom, and of course just using the bushes there in the neighborhood? The Scotts across the street have had a couple of disturbing issues with that.
Yeah.
And I don't know, it's not an easy fix, but something needs to be addressed there because we've witnessed it.
No, that's true. And
had that. I don't know how you fix it, but it is an issue, especially with lots of people.
You're absolutely right. And fortunately, one of the things that the Texas Parks and Wildlife Grant can pay for are not like porta potties, but nice lavs. I don't know where you'd put them, or you know, again, my house is right there, so I'm sensitive to that. I get the peeing in the bushes thing, but a nice lab would be nice. That is one of the things that grant could cover.
Lavatory.
Nice restrooms. Like with running water, like restrooms.
Dog.
A nice.
Yeah.
Yeah. Like
all right, well, can we use the microphone if you're going to address the audience?
I had the same problem. I took the boat out 4th of July, came back, golf cart needed help, you know, for him to move. And I looked over and someone's leaning against my truck, against the mirror, urinating on my tire. A citizen. Transit. Or what you want to say to people that come here. So, I mean, there's an issue. If nothing else, even a porta potty there. We got a contract because Deep Hole doesn't have anything like that. And that's
But no, Patrick, that's a valid concern. Thank you. We thought we brainstormed, and I don't know what the interim fix is. I know. Look at him smiling.
There goes your view.
Mayor and Council, you do have to realize that because of our new FEMA map, that area is not 14 feet.
Right.
That's
right.
It
has to be lifted.
16 feet.
That's right.
Yeah.
So
yeah.
That would be a,
that'd
that
be
would
a
be
really,
a really
high
nice
potty.
Potty with a really nice deck with a great view of the fireworks.
You just got to time
to
your bathroom break right.
Right.
Handicap. Yeah.
And handicap would be a really big issue with a really tall ramp.
Right.
But if anyone has any brainstorms for that, reach out to me. We couldn't come up with anything.
Remove the swimming ordinance.
Yeah.
All right.
great job, you guys.
Mm-hmm. Thank you.
Anything else from the public, the citizens, on that? All right. That concludes the meeting.